will be involved very heavily in this process. There was a motion made today to continue their discussion till next Tuesday. That passed almost unanimously. There was a subsequent motion that they would come here, that they would take a position to ask this council to continue this matter, and that failed. I think there were only two or three people supporting that motion. Vote, please.
Motion carries 4-1. Councilmember Zina dissenting.
Okay, we'll move into public discussion. We have a rather short meeting tonight. All of the public hearings probably will be continued. So I'm going to go to 7:30 with the public discussion. I'm picking up cards as I speak. And we'll take a break at 7:30 and then continue. We'll open up the public hearings and continue and then continue with public discussion after that. Michael Vole, please state your name and your city of residence for the record, please. Thank you.
Michael Vole, City of Thousand Oaks. I've lived in Thousand Oaks for the past 15 years, and I've made it a point not to get publicly involved in city politics. But after last week's decision regarding the Charles Probst issue, it's become unbearable for me to remain silent. Just to summarize, let me make sure I have this right. Charles Probst violated restrictions by the Planning Commission and by the Homeowners Association for the building of a maintenance building and landscaping around his home. The city orders him to halt any further work on the property. Then Mr. Probst donates to the city $2 million for the Arts Plaza. And not only are the violations lifted, but you name the 1,800-seat auditorium after him? I mean, am I the only one who finds this a little disturbing? Do you realize the kind of message that this is sending out to the people of this community? The message that we're sending is bad behavior gets rewarded for a price. Now, the paper states that the 1,800-seat auditorium will be named in honor of Mr. Probst. There is no honor in what he and this council have done. There's only shame. Those of you who have voted in favor of this have insulted every member of this community with this action. At the very least, change the decision to name the auditorium after this man, This kind of auditorium should be named for someone or something connected with this city that people can respect and be proud of, not sold to the highest bidder. Because if that's the case, Mr. Mayor, I have $20 here that I'd like a shrub named after me outside. Calling it change or bending the policies to make them more flexible. But the bottom line, ladies and gentlemen, is this is wrong. It is wrong. And this is not the voice of reason in this kind of decision making. Thank you.
Mr. Vole, may I point out to you that the hearing, the Probst hearing, was scheduled for mid-September. Okay? It was the people of North Ranch and the Homeowners Association that asked for a continuance. Okay? If the hearing had been held in mid-September, and I guarantee you, whether he gave 10 cents or 10 million, based on the circumstances of that particular matter, where he's trying to landscape his front yard, which I think you would enjoy doing, okay? I would have voted yes if last Tuesday night he withdrew the $2 million, I still would have supported a reasonable request to landscape and plant 11 acres of land, okay? And if we had done that in mid-September, you probably would have been here if we passed it then, and then he came in later and offered $2 million to have this the new auditorium named after him, you probably would have come in and said that was the payoff. I'm talking, Mr. Vole, please. The city found, at least this council person, found himself between a rock and a hard place, a no-win situation. If we passed it on the 15th of 20th of September, and he later made the contribution, he would have said that was a contribution for passing his program. We did it after he made the announcement. You're saying that was the payoff. It's nice to be in a win-win situation like that.
I would have a lot of interest in the city, but the point is that didn't happen. The point is it happened when it happened, and I am giving public comment viewing that, in my opinion, it's wrong.
So you really feel, that someone would pay $2 million to be able to have the privilege of planting his front yard with $2 million worth of shrubbery? You
really feel that the naming of such an auditorium of this stature should be open to the people of the city?
Sir, the name of this auditorium was up for sale for anyone that donated $2 million. You could have had it named after you if you came up with the $2
million. So it was for sale and not named after someone who's contributed?
It was named, there was a $2 million price tag to anybody that wished to donate it would have the auditorium named after him.
Well, as I said, when the shrubs become for sale, please let me know.
Okay, you can buy a shrub anytime you want. $20, sir. Mary Harris?
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Mary Harris, I live here in Thousand Oaks. All I wanted to do was to make a comment. Thank you, Mayor Fiore. I think it's only right that people have the right to do with their yard as they so desire. And I really feel that if anybody is a homeowner here, or if I was, I'm not, I'm a renter, so that doesn't bother me in the least. But I feel if people own a nice home and they want to do with their yard as they please to make it look nice, I think they should be able to. I think it's ludicrous that we're telling people they can't do what they want with their yard. That is totally insane. I would ask that really be rescinded and really looked at. The other thing that I am kind of discouraged about, last night at the Planning Commission, I watched it on TV, and I agree, yes, that we have to keep our ridgeline safe. I will agree with that, and it should not be built on. But by the same token, the Planning Commission, they didn't have enough information, but they want to put the PL overlay zone on certain properties, Lorena, Cal Lutheran, what have you. I don't think that Cal Lutheran should be touched. That college should be able, I feel, that's another property infringement to take their property rights away from them to be able to use their property. And I was glad Dennis Gillette was down there. I think he had a right to stand for what he believed in. And I'm hoping that this property does not get touched. I feel if he needs that property to build dorms for students coming in to go to college, or something comes up, he should be able to use that property, but not to be laying infringement rights to take his property. Council members, I have seen what is happening with this council, this planning commission. I don't think it's right to take property rights away from anybody. I don't think any of you would like it, and I don't think it's right for anybody else. I really think that we need to look at our policies, because at times I think we are too overly strict. I think if you're going to join a homeowners association, okay, that's your privilege. But I think we should also be neighborly. If people are out beautifying their yards, leave them alone. I mean, everybody's up to cause lawsuits and infringement rights on other people and being nosy. We shouldn't be doing that. That's terrible. I would ask you to please look at that. So this is why I'm here. The third thing and final, I want to compliment Grant Brimhall. I think as much as you have been through, I would compliment. You have been the best city manager, far none in this city. And as calm as you are, I compliment you. I just want to say I have the highest regard for you as far as a staff in the city. And I have a lot of liking for a lot more, but you are one of the tops that I think is really a person that I can't believe stays so calm through a lot of what happens in this city. So I just want to compliment you. I think you're a great person. Thank you.
Iqbal.
Iqbal Nick Kirwai, Newbury Park. Honorable Mayor, City Council. First of all, I want to thank you for keeping the 5 minutes, even though there's a lot of speakers. I would like to address this Prost donation and the landscaping. I know you have been quoted in the paper also, Honorable Mayor, for saying that the meeting was postponed by the Homeowners Association. And if the donation was announced afterwards, you just said that people would say that there is some kind of hanky-panky and some kind of involvement regarding the donation, and the decision was based on that. I think that would be speculation on the part of people to read into people's minds, and also trying to say why some people to try to access what the motive was for voting. And Also, from what I understand, this donation was in the works for a while, not just, it didn't happen overnight. And the donation is not all cash. That's what I heard on the morning radio station. So it does make put a whole cloud into it. And when the former mayor, his wife is here, says that the city prostituted itself. I mean, those are very strong words coming from a former mayor. And I hope that you will not dismiss this so lightly. I would like to let the people know, because this meeting is going to end shortly, I hope, that there is a forum or debate between Congressman Bielenson and the challenger, Mr. Siebert, and all the council candidates for the different elections will be there with tables, and I will be there. Mr. Dixon will be there as soon as we can get out from here. And it would be a great chance to meet. They will have breaks also. And so I would really encourage the people, if you're watching live, to go to CLU, to the auditorium, and listen to this forum. I also want to congratulate Mr. Olav Hassel, he's not here, and the council, for the success that you had finally in getting the low-income housing for the seniors. And I hope that since it's for the seniors that there would not be much controversy about it, and it's great that we got that. I do think highly of Mr. Brimhall, but I do have a kind of a complaint, I think I was instrumental in kind of changing your supplemental packet. It has had stuff that was not on the agenda, and letters that were addressed to the mayor. I told Mr. Murray, and I used the occasion myself to request that it should be put in this packet so that the press gets the copies of it and other people read the pink packet, now it's called the green packet, that it would be available to more people rather than going to the mayor or having copies to all the people. And I talked to staff today, I believe, and they said that only agendized items will be allowed on the supplemental information package. So I hope I have heard wrong. I hope the city manager or the council will act on it. Regarding your complaint earlier on regarding that trashy piece that was passed on low-income housing regarding that hearing, I just happen to have, I do have a whole library of city stuff, but I don't have it handy. And I got this little piece of paper about 2 years ago. It says the Conejo Free Review. And I'll just read the headline. City buries videotape, secret city meeting held behind closed doors, developers fees to finance jungle land. This did not have any name, and it was passed out at the council meeting 2 years ago, just before the election, and Mayor Lewis chastised the people. So maybe one of the reasons people are resorting to this thing is because of the escalation of the division that exists in the city. I just saw a planning commissioner in this chamber with a button. I mean, I thought buttons were supposed to be for four people, or maybe I'm one of the people that have a lot of negative buttons, but they are for projects, not for certain people, and he had one that says has a Z crossed out. So I cannot but assume that it's directed against council members and not their policies. And this is a piece of paper written by Mr. Jim Henson, who, and it was passed out amongst the literature of candidates at St. Pascal Church. Mr. Lazar was next to me when he saw it, and he was really upset about this. So it's going on from both sides, and I hope that we will put an end to it. I know my time is up. I'm always open to questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Gary Heathcote.
Mayor Fiore, members of the council. I'm here on behalf of the Chamber of Commerce to present another Fiore moment. And as part of our ongoing tribute to Mr. Fiore for his service to our city. Before beginning, I'd like to once again congratulate Mayor Fiore for being honored as the Humanitarian of the Year at the Chamber's annual banquet 2 weeks ago at Sherwood Country Club. This award is not given out every year, but only when persons deserve such attention and honor. This is certainly one of those times. As a relative newcomer to Thousand Oaks, at least compared to Alex, I was not here during the city's infancy, nor did I witness some of the key events which shape our community here today. But what I'd like to talk about tonight is Wildwood Park and the Wildwood Mesa. With its miles of hiking and riding trails, day camp sites, and beautiful panoramas, it remains a standing hallmark to your concern for our community. Let me read from a paragraph of the Conejo Valley historical account of our area. The largest land donation came in December 1966, a sort of Christmas present to the community, when Potrero Homes, a partnership of Jans Corporation, donated 1,250 acres of canyon and mesa land near California Lutheran University, valued at that time of $16.8 million. Still, what would be Wildwood Park without the mesa standing tall and unblemished above the park? The historical account continues. One of our last prime pieces of parkland was secured in the mid-1980s, saved at the last minute from the bulldozer and the developer when the city and the park reached an agreement to preserve the 240-acre Wildwood Mesa at the western end of Avenida de los Arboles. This account, like much of history, leaves out one important fact. Who, in fact, made this happen at the last minute, of course, was Alex Fiore. Thank you and good evening.
Thank you, Mr. Heathcote. I think maybe we should name a few bushes after that Potrero outfit. John Ellis?
John Ellis, Thousand Oaks. Wish I could see. Sooner or later, this city council is going to have to start listening. You simply don't have enough money to continue to ignore the people who bring you information that will save this city money. 1 year ago, a group of citizens came into this place and told you that you were building a building, this facility, that was a mess, that would not be safe and would not be usable by the disabled. You not only insulted them in every possible way, I've never seen you better at your job than that night. But you, of course, ignored them. Every attempt during the past year, you've ignored it. Let's face it. We're never going to agree. Yesterday I wrote you a letter. You'll have your copies. Your staff has already got them for review, and they should have answers and be able to reply to them. First one pointed out two major life-threatening situations in the Provost Theater. I don't expect you to fix it, because that's the way you are. However, at least the disabled or their heirs will be able to collect damages from the city, and maybe the city attorney will like to explain that to you, because of your negligence and refusal to fix that theater. Today we were in the theater. A number of your staff went there. We went there for purposes of training the ushers, help them, assist them, try to mitigate the situations we find over there. Although I made notes on innumerable violations, the one that caught my attention immediately was the open shaft, or the open lift shaft, similar to an elevator shaft. That scared me, quite frankly. That's the thing, maybe I watched too many horror movies or something. But that's the kind of thing that kills and injures people. You want to know what happened when I brought it to the attention of your man that's responsible for it? He couldn't see anything wrong with it. He kept pointing to a little one-inch lip down in front of it that was okay. Now, I don't know what he's going to say tonight, but I remind him there were witnesses to his comments. another category. There is a category of individual disabled that come in assistive devices, wheelchairs as an example. They pull their wheelchairs up to an aisle seat which has a removable or no armrest, and they transfer it. Basically, they slide over. I started hunting for them in the Probst Theater. I couldn't find any. They're required to be marked. You can do that easily. The only problem is that the only two that even partially meet the requirements, only two of them, and they only partially meet the requirements, that a wheelchair can reach. Now, there's supposed to be 18 over there, a minimum of 18. I can't find that many, even of the others that don't work. And the reason they don't work, and we ended up in a big discussion, and your theater consultant was brought in, and like I say, we're never going to disagree. We're never going to agree. Because your theater consultant insisted there was no need for a wheelchair to be able to get to a seat to transfer into it. Now that, you know, is that stupid? Does anybody read the regulations? Does anybody know that when the power fails, that there's no area of rescue assistance over there for anyone, including the disabled, to retreat to? Does anyone know that none of those seats that I just talked about are in this facility? There are nothing but problems. The Probst Theater is the most serious situation. Let's take this situation, for instance. You even took and rearranged it so the disabled have to crawl over the city clerk in their wheelchairs to get up there. Now, come on, cut it out. Any questions?
No questions, sir.
Now, let your staff have at it.
Raul Gutierrez.
Raul Gutierrez, Thousand Oaks. Bill Rogers said, "All I know is what I read in the papers." And I read an article published in the Ventura County section of the Los Angeles Times dated September 30, 1994. And I would like to read an excerpt from that article. Retired businessman Marshall Dixon emphasized the need to link Newberry Park with the rest of Thousand Oaks and put an end to the us against them state of mind, which is probably the biggest problem to overcome. Taking the opposite tack, incumbent Eloy Zena urged residents to secede from and form an independent city if they remain dissatisfied with their elected officials. "You have the financial base with the Rancho Conejo Industrial Park," she said, shaking her fists as if rallying her troops. Now, last week, when I appeared before this council, Council Member Zena denied making this statement. I read it in the paper. And somewhere, and some of the candidates that were at that forum are here tonight. Perhaps you can ask them to corroborate what the story said, or what the reporters saw, or what I said last week. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mr. Gutierrez.
Mr. Mayor, I have some comments to make. First of all, I think Mr. Gutierrez was at that forum, and he knows that I did not urge them, that I had commented in relationship to some comments that other candidates had said, that some residents of Newberry Park had talked about that if they, because they're concerned about representation on the city council. I think it's time for Mr. Gutierrez, since he is using our public concern section for partisan politics, to say what candidate he is actively supporting in this race. It is an incumbent, and I think that it's time, since Mr. Gutierrez has embarked on a vicious smear campaign.
I think
it
we're
has
getting
taken
it.
Multifaceted.
I think we're getting into
Mr.
an
Mayor,
area that we
this
shouldn't.
This is personal
be.
Privilege. Mr. Gutierrez has come up here.
How many times,
times?
How many times, Madam Mayor, have you shut me off on personal privilege when someone took pot shots at me from that lectern?
I haven't, as a matter of
fact.
You
haven't?
I would like to make one comment to the community. At the beginning of the summer, a high city official went to a friend of mine, and he started asking some very personal questions about me, about my family, about my children, my husband. And when he wasn't satisfied that I didn't have any skeletons in the closet, he confided to this man, if we don't find it, we're going to make it up. There is the most vicious smear sheet that Mr. Gutierrez is passing around that has started that big lie. And I think the community should just be aware that this is happening. I hope you won't condone it. And I'm really sorry that it's happened right here in our city of Thousand Oaks. Thank you.
I also think...
No, we can't get into that. You could fill out a speaker's card if you... You could fill out a speaker's card in the public comments, Mr. Dixon. I wish we would get out of this. This thing's been going on a little bit too long. It seems to me that when someone gets up and insults the integrity of either myself or Mrs. Lazar or Mr. Shillow, everything is fine. But as soon as it turns on the other shoe or on the other foot, it's a travesty and it shouldn't be done. And I think if we're going to allow the public to speak, just let them speak. And those that wish to believe what's being said can believe what's being said, and those who wish not to don't have to. I can say this, that the piece of paper I quoted tonight had no name on it. No idea of who it came from. Other stuff emanating out of Newbury Park is written with no name identification as to who's doing it. At least Mr. Henson, whoever he is, and I don't know who he is, put his name on his piece of paper for everyone to know who it was. And Mr. Gutierrez gets up here and makes his statements with everyone knowing who says who is saying what, rather than hiding behind letters to the editor with unlisted numbers that you can't even, you try to call and they have an unlisted number, they're not listed in the paper, or sending out flyers, tearing down signs, and all of that. I think
because
it's very inappropriate.
Excuse me, because we have such a serious ethics problem here, I also feel that I must point out that Mr. Gutierrez uses the name of the Civic Arts Plaza in a booth, in a public forum, to distribute his buttons of Z with a cross through it. I mean, are swastikas next?
Hey,
I just feel
try
that
being
the man
recall,
has misrepresented
try being recall
himself.
Sometime and see what misrepresentations are all about, and you'll appreciate it. What did they do on the recall attempt with Frank Shillow and myself but put Jungle Land with an X through it when they were attempting to recall us for other reasons?
But I know this is a friend of yours, but it should be known that he is using
next
the city
speaker
name
will be
for
Mr. Henson. We see you for the first time. I don't need one. I won't be here. Your name and city of residence for the record, please, Mr. Henson.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My name is Jim Henson, a.k.a. Justin Grant, Thousand Oaks. Don't worry, Mrs. Zena, this isn't going to be a Q&A tonight. Even if it was, your supporters blast every other city council member all year long. Why should we call a moratorium for just 1 month? I came here tonight to set the record straight about my letters to the editor and to voice my concerns. To understand why I've gotten involved, let's go back in time a year. About a year ago, I was financially destitute. I was out of job, and I was as close to being as homeless.